This is the story of Raul Speek Almeida, a Cuban painter born in the year of the revolution who traveled the world and came to Wales seeking freedom. Here he found peace, tranquility, and inspiration. But did he find home? Raul was one of the most promising young artists to come out of the fertile 80s Cuban art scene. But like many of his contemporaries, he found the rigid control of Castro's regime unbearable. And after many brushes with the authorities, he decided to leave. In 1991, he traveled to the UK on a three-week visa and never returned. Although he's been living in West Wales for the last 3 years, Raul's work doesn't seem on first viewing to be influenced by his surroundings. Rather than featuring the muted tones of the Welsh coastline, his paintings explode with the loud tropical energy of his homeland. Traveling easily between abstract and figurative, they embrace the whole tradition of Latin American art, from sensuous portraiture to symbolic scenes, featuring references to sexuality, religion, and Raul's African and native Indian heritage.
I think somehow I like to be in touch with who I am, because I'm a tropical painter. I think my colors are tropical. I'm specialized in tropical color. If I'm in Japan, I will still painting with the color who I grow up. All this color coming from fruit color, no, mango tree, banana tree, because I don't haven't seen yet a color beautiful than that.
Landscapes have always played an important part in Raul's art. He never works from sketches or reality, but rather creates lush dreamscapes by blending memories from his Caribbean homeland and elements of his present life. Since he's been working in Solva, the influences of the austere Pembrokeshire countryside have been gradually appearing on his canvases.
In Cuba, we have plenty of green, 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 green. But this tree is like a Welsh winter tree, and it's like a mixture of feeling there, like you have got a sky like this, very silver. It's like a Welsh sky, Welsh countryside, mixture with the Cuban countryside. I could reach the British people or the people who come in here with this kind of painting, and I'm happy with that, because I'm nothing without people. Painting is nothing without people.
Upon his arrival in Europe, Raul first lived in London. But eventually the agitation of the capital proved too much, and he longed for tranquility and isolation. While on holiday in Wales with his wife, he fell in love with the open skies of Pembrokeshire and decided to move there. The couple bought an old chapel in the village of Solva and made the move in the autumn of 96. The windswept village at the edge of the cliffs might seem a long way from the sunny Caribbean beaches of Raul's past, but for him, moving to Solva was like a homecoming.
I think the reason why I belong to here is because, think about very clear now, I come from a place who is called Guantanamo. They call this town of the sea and the mountains. And here you have the mountain, and you have the sea, and you have the town. And it's like a miniature of Guantanamo. In London, you know that you are a foreigner, even as many black people. But in here in Solva, I don't notice that people say, oh, who are you? No, I don't notice that. People are said to me like anybody else. And I love the place. I would not live anywhere else in the world. If I had to live anywhere in the place, in the world, I'd go back to Cuba.
Ten years after his departure from Cuba, Raul has finally decided to go home for a visit. After months of waiting for his visa, the moment has come, and he's flying out to Havana with his wife Heather in a couple of days. Since he's been away, Cuba's been the main source of inspiration for his art. But with time, the memories have become distorted, and he now feels that it's time to face up to reality.
In order to confront my new life in here, I had to try to forget everything about Cuba because I was so far away. I am not the same person who left Cuba 10 years ago. No, I'm a 40-year-old now. And I like to go to confirm that Cuba is a beautiful place, still a beautiful place, how I was a child.
When he departed abruptly from Cuba, Raul left behind a lot of unresolved issues. His family never really accepted his decision to be an artist and was opposed to his outspoken political views. Even today, there's no guarantee of their acceptance of Raul. Although he's hoping that the political situation has relaxed since he left and will allow him to dialogue more freely, he's also concerned with how he will deal with the potential changes.
All the time I have the telephone, I talk with people in Cuba, they say, you will be surprised, you will be shocked, you will be amazed of how Cuba is now. But I will confront my past. And I will try to, I don't know, I have no idea of the Cuba who will be there. I don't know, I can't imagine. I don't want to imagine that.
On the surface, nothing much has changed in Havana. Like before, the sun shines on the Malecón, the huge boulevard stretching alongside Havana Bay. But as Raul takes his first steps for a decade in Old Havana, he discovers a town changed beyond recognition. When he was a hungry young painter, he spent most of his time in this area, a poor neighborhood of rotting colonial houses where artists, criminals, and dreamers found shelter and got drunk on cheap rum. Today, the old buildings are being renovated into expensive hotels, and the streets, watched by police, are overflowing with tourists. 10 years ago, a Cuban caught with a $1 bill in his pocket would have gone to prison. Today, poverty is still everywhere, but the American currency rules, and everything is for sale in the open. Rum, cigars, sex, voodoo, and music. A stone's throw away from Old Havana, Maria Antonia, Raul's elder sister, still lives in the same two-bedroom apartment she's been sharing with her husband and two kids since she was looking after Raul and when he used to sleep on the sofa.
Yo voy a ser médico, René es un ingeniero, y yo entendía que si ese que estaba al lado mío, que se quedara detrás. Entonces esa fue siempre la lucha constante, el motivo de nuestros disgustos, porque discutíamos mucho sobre eso. Y dice, tú tienes que lograr instruirte, no solamente ser pintor. Y tanto fue que él logró llegar a una escuela de un técnico medio, graduarse en técnico medio. Fue inclusive hasta profesor de electrónica en una escuela. Y cuando trajo el título, me dijo, mira, cuélgalo por ahí porque yo no lo quiero. Lo mío es la cultura. Ya con este libro no hay remedio. Yo me sentía dolida de que a lo mejor quizás yo no había ayudado a que él se evolucionara rápidamente en la pintura. Yo me sentía siempre esa pena por dentro, ¿no? Y él, ahí estando allá, en una de las cartas, me dice que él comprendió allá la importancia de lo que yo le decía en aquellos tiempos.
Porque tú estás en Cuba y no te das cuenta. Pero cuando tú sales de Cuba, yo recuerdo que cuando estaba en Brasil, en el hotel, toda la gente que limpiando el piso y sirviente, todo era negro. Pero lo que más me preocupó era que cuando yo conversaba con esa gente, ellos no saben que en otras partes tú eres negro, chino, blanco, de cualquier raza que tú eres, que tú tienes derecho a la educación. Ellos piensan que toda la vida ellos van a ser limpiando el piso o no. Y yo dije, ah, no, porque Cuba, e inmediatamente yo me di cuenta que Cuba tiene como 100 años adelante.
Raul is frustrated by the commercialism that has taken over Havana. In the backyard of some artist friends, he tries to reclaim some of the spirit of the old days by doing what he does best. Far away from the madness of Havana is Raul's hometown, Guantanamo, a place that time forgot. When Raul was living here, it was still a prosperous provincial town nestling in a rich coffee and sugar-producing area. The bitter years of economic deprivation that followed the collapse of the Cuban economy in the early 90s have hit places like Guantanamo very hard. Today, the town is a shadow of its former self. Work is scarce, food and petrol are often in acute shortages. The tourists with their much-desired dollars rarely stop here. The young people leave the countryside in droves for the prospect of a better life in Havana.
¿Y la panadería? ¿Qué es que estaba el patio de la casa que la Rebeca y comía
el pan? El patio nuestro va a quedar con la casa.
No podía. ¿Tú te cuentas de mí, Raúl? ¿Le dijo Juanica?
Originally, Raúl's family were farmers in the hills close to Guantanamo. When he was only three, his mother died on her way to give birth at the town's hospital, and survival in the harsh surroundings of the isolated farm became impossible. Raul, the youngest child of the family, was sent to Guantanamo to be looked after by relatives, who eventually adopted him. He grew up in a small house, 1167 West Street.
No, pero aquí había una columna. Entonces había otra columna aquí y había un filtro.
Un filtro en medio.
Yo un filtro en medio. Ya. Entonces había aquí una cama que se venía aquí. Y perrito, oyendo radio, no, que no se oye la vaina.
Radio, sí.
Ya. Ya es increíble.
Se recuerda todo, mi madre.
Ya. Yeah. It's like about 20 years I never come here and still completely, absolutely the same. This is like a, has been stopped for the time machine since 1950. Very deep into my blood, I am like this. O sea, I feel in here I'm who I am.
Most of Raul's family still lives in Guantanamo. Barbaro, Raul's eldest brother, is a crane operator and a member of the Communist Party. Although he was originally quite opposed to Raul's choice of career, he still takes immense pride in the circumstances that allowed Raul to become an artist.
Raul nace con la revolución ya. Ya hay conocimiento, ya hay principios.